Dave Namazzi with the University of Maryland Center for Environmental Science. I'm going to be facilitating this next session, which is basically saying, where are we now? Where are we going? And there's no two better people to help describe that for us, both watershed-wide and Maryland-wide. And I'm first going to introduce both speakers now. So the first speaker is going to be Rich Batiuk, who has been leading the effort as the Associate Director for Science Analysis and Implementation with the Chesapeake Bay Program, US EPA office. He's been doing that for over 20 years. He's a tremendous bundle of energy. If you haven't heard him speak, hold on. He's going to show us a lot of stuff pretty quickly. Rich, I'm going to give you, you got about 20, 25 minutes. I'm going to give you a 2-minute signal in there. Following Rich is going to be Lee Currey, who has been leading the Science Services Administration as part of MDE. He's been leading that group for 5 years now. He's also a tremendous, speaker who really understands and is really very closely watching what we've accomplished, its impact, where do we need to go. So with that, first, Rich, thank you very much.
Being height impaired, I can't stand behind a podium there, so I got to stand out here as well. So buckle your seatbelts. We're going to take a ride around the watershed, and then Lee's going to land you here in Maryland as well. Don, start getting your nutrient credits. I'm sorry, because your ashes can't go in the Chesapeake Bay. You know, when you die in 2070, we're going to put you in the Mississippi Basin, buddy, because nitrogen, phosphorus, you know, you've gained up a lot. I know a lot of calcium in there, but sorry. We take our trading program seriously, don't we? So either over the Gulf or you start putting in that point. So let's roll. Where are we now? You're about to hear in another couple weeks some fantastic news on the Bay Grasses front in terms of what's happening out there. I'm going to take you first through the watershed, not a piece of model output, all monitoring data. That in fact, the news is good out there. We are seeing this ecosystem 30 plus years later is responding. There are certainly signs out there in terms of nitrogen, phosphorus, and sediment. There are places that it's improving. There are places that we're still concerned about it. There are places that are not going the right direction. But your efforts collectively and your partners around this six state, 64,000 square miles, are making a difference. Some of us spend our entire lives wanting to move one little regulation, one little piece. We're actually moving an ecosystem. Are we there yet? Heck no. But we are seeing clear signs of resilience. We're seeing responses. We're also seeing some stubbornness in that system as well. So what, give you a big picture. This is a collective effort across the six states and the District of Columbia and our USGS colleagues. What I want to show you is we got about 80 stations heading up to 120 that are taking the pulse of rivers and streams and creeks across the Chesapeake. Take a look at here. If you're on the green side, what this means for nitrogen is that you're reducing a per pound per acre load across that system. You can see 60, 70 different systems out there that are in fact responding over time. On the other side is orange. That means you're going in the wrong direction. So we are actually seeing good positive trends across the watershed. We're understanding where they're coming from. But as Ben mentioned as well, one of the ones that we're not seeing is a Conowingo. It is flattening out in terms of nitrogen coming down. It's not just a phosphorus issue. I'm not going to blame Pennsylvania. There are others on the eastern shore, western shore, down in Virginia that we've got a challenge there. But looking to the north, we've got to move that one. That is the ground zero for Chesapeake Bay. If we don't bring the Susquehanna, New York, Pennsylvania, Maryland, we're not going to get a Chesapeake Bay in there as well. But it is working out there. The groundwater is responding. The creeks, the rivers, it's not just wastewater, not just atmospheric deposition. We're seeing stormwater. We're seeing the pieces of ag. So not many people can look at six states and say, hey, it looks good. You can go to Tampa Bay. You can go to the small systems. That's pretty impressive for the Chesapeake. But our concern is some of that momentum, as I'll show you, we're flattening out. We've got to continue to maintain that. Here's an interesting picture as well. So what you're looking at is the bay pollution diet from a monitoring perspective. Here's our best understanding. This is what they call the river input. So this is above the fall line, above those tidal areas. This is non-point sources below the fall line, wastewater treatment plant, atmospheric deposition. Pretty good across the board. In other words, over that decadal period, we're seeing 14% over the last 20 years, 8% more recently. We still need to get 30, 40, 50% in the real monitoring data. So this is not model outputs. This is what we're actually seeing occurring out there. But you've got the mighty Susquehanna being a big chunk. Your other major rivers, the James, the York, the Rappahannock, the Choptank, the Patuxent, the Potomac, Choptank on there, and then across the board there. But we're seeing big reductions in terms of wastewater, atmospheric depositions captured up in here. But yeah, heading in the right direction. Do we have more to go? Most definitely. And that's the challenge we've got today is, how do we continue to make that happen? Phosphorus, slightly different story. You're not seeing as large of yield reductions across all the watersheds. Again, 80 different watersheds, from the big ones to the small ones, across that system. But still, we are seeing reductions. We are seeing a response in the system, early because of wastewater, more recently because of ag and stormwater efforts that are happening out there. But again, our mighty Conowingo is going in the wrong direction up here, even though we see, Pennsylvania reminds me of every day, we're seeing good downward trends over here. We're seeing good trends in the Potomac, a little bit in the Virginia portion as well. Phosphorus is still going to be a challenge for us. We thought decades ago we had solved it. Not yet. We got to continue to work on that as well. But heading in the right direction, a lot of places, some places are still stubborn out there, but we've got good data to take a look at it. This is disturbing. So when you look at that, remember the nitrogen trends, pretty much going all the way down. Our river input stations heading in the wrong direction, and when you're taking it cumulatively, and then below fall line in our tidalist sections, and then wastewater treatment plants. Here's what's happening. For the most part, when you look at the other rivers combined, yeah, they take a hump up here, and then they head further down on 2014, 2015. So that Susquehanna going in the wrong direction. We certainly can look at the dam, we can look at the settling capacity, but the bottom line is we've got to take more phosphorus out of the Susquehanna before it gets to Conowingo. We've got to work upstream, we've got to figure out some innovative solutions in that system as well. But not everybody else has got to do a lot more than what we've got out there as well. We've taken that out of wastewater, there's not much more you're going to pull out of that onion. We've got more work to do with our farming community, with our stream restoration efforts. We've got more work to do with our urban stormwater efforts as well. We know how to deal with it. We're getting better understanding of that phosphorus science out there. We've got to continue to implement good phosphorus indices. We've got to take a look at it as well. But not just, I want to point all of the way up to the Susquehanna. You look at the Potomac, good long downward trends starting to flatten out there. We can't afford to do that. We've got to be accelerating. We can't be affording to be slowing down here as well. So what does it look when you get into the Chesapeake? We could spend hours looking at grasses and looking at individual trends. For the most part, you're seeing signals of that particular work. Mindy's smiling because this is her work back there from University of Maryland, Center for Environmental Sciences as well. So what we're looking at is the Chesapeake Bay currently from a water quality standards perspective. Do I have enough oxygen out there? Do I have enough light for underwater grasses? Do I have grasses in my nooks and crannies out there? How's the algae doing there as well? This one's really focused on dissolved oxygen in here. So if you're in green or blue, you're at attainment. Blue, you're heading in that direction. We've got some downward arrows in some of the systems as well. But from our open water habitats, if you're a rockfish, Spanish mackerel coming up from the Virginia waters, we're making some progress. It takes a lot to change big volumes of water and dissolved oxygen. When you go down below the picnic line a little bit, or in the picnic line here, you're in crab habitat, you're at spot croaker. A lot of us enjoy fishing for those bottoms feeding fish out there. Still got problems here in the main stem. This is not our where Don wants to end up entombed down there, guys. This is not in that area. That's over there. This is still important habitat, important places to do it. We're seeing some signals down in Virginia waters, but we're not seeing green all the way through. We haven't gotten there. Are we starting to see a signal in the deep areas? Yes. The canary in the proverbial coal mine, I would have not thought I would see in my career the needle starting to move on dissolved oxygen. It is starting to do it. Has it gotten there? No. But you're starting to see that signal. We're not going to see much more until we take that Susquehanna faucet, that Potomac faucet, and dial it down. And then down in the deep channel parts of the Chesapeake, as I said, we're not seeing it in the standards, but we're starting to see within the monitoring data the beginnings of a movement in there as well. What the system is telling us, you go another 10, 20, 25 million pounds, we're likely to start to see a rebound in that particular system. The importance of it is, people say, so why, I can't swim down there, I can't put a troll that deep unless I'm looking for that big mother rockfish out there. The importance is between zero oxygen and 1 milligram per liter. You make that switch right there, makes a difference. When Don was out with Pocahontas and John Smith, 1620, they had a hydro lab, and they were looking at dissolved oxygen. They might have seen around 3 milligrams per liter. We see that in the historical record. We're not trying to get there with 18 million people, folks. But the difference in that chemistry, you change from zero to one, you've all of a sudden held that phosphorus down there, you've allowed the nitrogen go off as nitrogen gas, and you've made John Smith and Pocahontas happy because that system will now do what she should be doing all the way through, and that is taking care of that extra nitrogen and phosphorus, holding some of it back, and giving enough to good, healthy algae. But nowhere else in the world has got the kind of monitoring program that we're seeing here in the tidal waters, supported by others, including those models that Don poked at. Are we making progress? Yes. But if you look at that at the long term, it is hard to squint at this. So you're talking around the 20s in terms of bay-wide of how much time and space in the Chesapeake are meeting our water quality standards. In other words, good oxygen, good clarity, enough light out there, good food. To out here, yeah, we're maybe in the 40s or something like that, but we haven't seen that. We're hitting up against the fact that we're starting to, but we haven't changed that nutrient diet for algae out there as well. So just imagine if we closed all the doors here, sealed them off, and allowed Don to talk for another 2 or 3 hours and absorb a lot of the oxygen in here. We might get, maybe some of it's going to last a couple minutes, maybe an hour or two. But that's like it is in the Chesapeake, not just in those deep areas, but in some of our shallows. Not enough oxygen. That's not a healthy system. So we know what we need to do. We've got a sense of it as well. We've got to push that extra. The Chesapeake's in sending signals that you get me over here, I will change. Last year when we saw some tremendous clarity of water out there across the Chesapeake, you could get a glimpse of what it might look like out there as well. So, but given that we're not there yet, one of the things that my agency does is provide some wonderful oversight. So here's a picture of the view from, are you as a state on track to get your commitments by 2017? Do you have the capacity to deliver by 2025? It's not as a pretty picture as it should be out there. If you're in red, like our colleagues to the north there, that means that you have serious problems about delivering the capacity to do that. If you're in enhanced oversight, that means there are signals out there that you need to take action, to put legislation in place, to have regulatory efforts out there, to have compliance assurance, to have good voluntary efforts as well. These are not all regulatory pieces. It's a mix of all the programs that you all oversee, but looking towards, are they on track to make that happen out there as well? The objective is to keep everybody in green and keep them on trajectory. If there's a yellow or red there, means that we've got work to do it. This is not poking fingers. This is recognizing we've got to, all of us have got to step up, because it's got to be all green for us to want to get there as well. So let me take a couple minutes to talk about where we're going. One of the key first things is, as Ben even mentioned as well, and that is tracking, verifying practices out there. We've got to ensure that as we're putting every piece on there, whether it's a cover crop, whether it's a bioinfiltration system, it's not worth that investment of public and private dollars unless we know that it's in fact working. So we've got to continue to do that. The good news is, the key number on here is, we're up to around 368 definitions of practices, treatments, technologies across stormwater, across stream restoration, and looking at tidal waters, looking at agricultural sectors, looking at stormwater. The partnership has agreed to, here's the science behind these practices, here's how to track them, here's how to model them. We're heading towards around 400 by this next year. Here's just the beginning of a list of what we've got out there in terms of what the partnership has agreed to. And that continues for 11 more slides. So folks are saying, hey, listen, you know, you're not capturing my favorite practice. My gosh, guys, if there's science behind it, bring it forward. Let's do it. Unfortunately, it takes us a little while. This is our process for making decisions among this partnership of, is there enough science on cover crops to do it? And Kristen's smiling up here. I could tell you the answer, man. So, yeah, it's a little complicated. But we've got 19 different panels out there, from floating wetlands to looking at oysters, to looking at agricultural ditches, thanks to my colleague up there, Chris from Delaware, pushing on that one. So we are looking at every sector, every piece. Let's get more innovative. Let's, you all in the room, talk about the practices, the treatment, the technologies we need to do to get there as well. And then finally, before wrapping up here, one of the key things, I'd like to put a challenge to my Maryland colleagues out there. You are good. I won't call you great, because then all the other jurisdictions will get all pissy about it. Well, you called Maryland great, but we're the Commonwealth, so we're good. You're doing some darn good stuff out there. So I want to push you guys a little bit in one particular area, and that is, you're on track for wastewater. You got a good program in place for stormwater, for ag. Take the efforts that you're underway of looking at tracking where there's growth and how you're going to offset with your trading program and others, and show the rest of the jurisdictions how we're going to get there. So what I want to lay out as quickly is some thoughts that are out there. some things that we might be thinking about and how we can continue to work together to do that. So we've got a lockbox down here. So for some watershed or a state out there, here's the direction we want to go. We need to get there. We've got a sense of, as Ben mentioned, we're going to be stepping back and taking a look at the allocation responsibilities among the six states and opportunities for the states to then say, can I make some shifts between sectors, between geography, encouraging the other jurisdictions to go more local in terms of the set of responsibilities. But that's where we want to go. There's a trajectory that somebody could follow over time as well. But what we also want to do is to continue to work with jurisdictions and looking out in time and saying by 2025, as climate change and as other things continue to take hold of the watershed, what are we likely to see in terms of the way of growth over time? And then we understand, hey, listen, we need to then, as a part of the midpoint assessment, continue to confirm that here's what we're expecting from that watershed, from that jurisdiction, from that source sector, but also, what are we expecting, what level of growth from what sectors, from what locations, because of our you know, continued folks coming into the Maryland area, wanting to grow a little particular place that may not be infilling out there. So let's continue to quantify that. And then as we develop the phase three watershed implementation plans, looking out towards how are we going to get to those hard nuts to crack, as Don mentioned, by 2025. We're going to keep that lockbox. We understand with good science what the Chesapeake, what the Choptank, what the Potomac, what the Wicomico, the Nanjamoin, the, you know, you name your creek out there. We've got a good understanding of what loads those systems can withstand. Then we've got to continue to focus on that. And we know what we need to then continue to work towards, combine those together. That's what we want those phase three WIPs to look at. What are not only where do we need to go from here, how do you continue to offset that over time? So part of what we're looking at is, hey, listen, if you look at a state, we're not pointing at Maryland, but if you're in here, out in 2019, that means that not only have you not reduced what you need to, you're not offsetting growth. So what into the future we want to be sure is not just you're upgrading that treatment plant, putting that biofiltration system, putting that cover crop for the reductions that you need for your conservation district, your municipality. We need to also be saying, hey, listen, you've got to offset the growth for that area or for somebody else out there as well. But if you're in that case, you're on trajectory, EPA looks good. We give Lee Currey and his team a green light. Keep moving, folks. Oftentimes, we're finding ourselves in here. We're making some progress towards here. We may be offsetting, but we're not looking at the combined set to keep on track to make that happen. So what we're looking for is, as we continue in time, and we make progress here, we get better estimates, as what Ben mentioned, in terms of we're getting better imagery out there. We're understanding where that growth pattern is occurring, not just in Maryland, but across all six states. We make a better estimate of what the growth projections are for that county, for that municipality, for that source sector. We reset where we're made progress down here. We need to continue to do this and just keep building in, thinking about offsetting growth as a part of your natural programs, whether you're delivering conservation to farmers, we're working with municipalities, you're working with NGOs out there as well. And then we continue to take a look with our three-year milestones and keep through that process as well. So finally, what are the other challenges? Lee is going to take you through some very good Maryland graphics and challenges out there. I want to lay a couple of them in addition to the offsets over time. And that's climate change. People say, oh yeah, they talk it into the future tense. I'm sorry, but we've already been experiencing it. We've seen changes, several degree temperature changes in our tidal waters. Could you imagine, you know, fighting back and forth in your house of turning that thermostat down and up, and every year or two you start to turning another degree up, another degree up. After a while, you're going to get uncomfortable. The system is already seeing responses in there. We're seeing some level of in terms of local climate pieces in there as well. So we've got to not only look towards the future, we need to understand what's impacting us now and working through it as well. Conowingo, it's certainly, it's lovely when those eagles are up there, but it's not too lovely when you're seeing the 15 or 20 of those dams opening up there. That's something certainly we want to continue to work with you all and with Maryland and our Pennsylvania colleagues and your colleagues to resolve out there. This one's one of those ones that sort of captures it. So this is data at Conowingo, and we've seen this a lot in the Chesapeake across the board. Good downward trends into the 90s, early 2000 time period. A lot of work out there, a lot of upgrades of treatment plants, a lot of work on soils moving towards no-till with our farms, folks really getting good on the urban stormwater side, looking at stream restoration. In other systems as well, we're seeing a bump midpoint in here and then a flattening out. We're seeing in the Potomac, they're seeing it on the James. It's not like it's one jurisdiction or another. There's something, you know, whether it's those that easy to pick fruit, we've done all those pieces, and we got a crack of, I was going to say nuts in the room here, we won't go there. But to really do that, it's systematic across the system. So we've got to figure out how to take that. This is real data. This is not model output. And how are we going to continue it to head down towards there? But the fact that we've seen something like that, even for the Susquehanna, the Potomac, et cetera, is something to celebrate. People, as I said, they've worked on ecosystems for their entire lives. They don't get to see that. You cannot see that signal. Look at how noisy that is. Our USGS colleagues have brought some great science into there, but the fact that you can see that against that noise is that system is responding. Is it there yet? Hell no. Is it on the trajectory to get there? Not right now, but we know what we've got to do in order to continue to turn that as well. And then finally, the challenge that you all in all the six states and our localities and our conservation districts and our NGOs face, and that is, do we have the programmatic, the policy, the regulatory, the legislative, the funding, and the political will to make it happen before Don dies? I'm sorry, he's going to be our new symbol of here's the Bay Restoration out there. Seriously, can we deliver on that particular scale? Lee is going to challenge you with some of the trends that you've got, the trajectory you've got there as well. We need to be sure we've got that capacity built in every place that we've got. So that's one of the things that your EPA colleagues are going to do. We're not going to be snooping around. We're going to really continue to be focused on, do you have the programmatic, the policy, the regulatory, the funding capacity to deliver? Because if you do, we're going to turn our direction towards another state, another jurisdiction, another sector. If you don't, you're going to see more of us, and it's not, well, we're not too bad to deal with as well. But this is going to be one of the key issues we're going to look at. We're not just going to look at model output. We're going to look at the length of the record out there. We're going to look at monitoring data. We need to hold folks' feet to the fire to what we're actually seeing out there, what they've been able to deliver, and are they actually looking 3-4 years ahead? We're fortunate to have the Bay Commission and Ann and her team looking across the three states, at least, and pushing legislation, but it's got to go further than that as well. And with that, I will finish up. Thank you.
We're going to hold questions, so if you have a question for Rich, just please write it down. We're going to hold questions in the, until after Lee's presentation, and that'll give us more time for Q&A for both of them to be able to respond.
All right, well, good morning, everyone. Lee Currey with Maryland Department of Environment. I have to say, I mean, it's really just an honor and a privilege to come up here and to be able to talk to all the folks in the room. Tremendous amount of diversity, a lot of respect, a lot of folks I've worked with for quite some time. And I hope you enjoy the trip that you're on right now with, or this ride where Rich is taking you from the watershed scale. What I want to do is bring you down to more of the Maryland perspective, putting a finer point on where we are. This is really one of my favorite slides, honestly. It's really simple. There's been a lot of poking at models, but I have to admit, you know, we need our monitoring information. We have almost 200 monitoring stations throughout the watershed. We need that information, but if we want to understand the sources of our pollution and to work at a finer scale and to target our implementation, we really need those modeling tools. So this chart right here was developed with almost 200 stations, 4 million records of flow went into it, more than 50,000 nitrogen, phosphorus, and sediment samples. So when we hear about the modeling tools, they do help us, and they're informed by all the monitoring information that you've just seen. So I like this point of view. In 2014 for Maryland, where are we? And it's good to look at the big source sectors, whether it's agriculture, which is the orange, urban runoff, which is the red, or wastewater. And you can see the way I look at this, about half of our nutrients are coming from agriculture, and about the other half is coming from development. And if you look in development, it's really two parts to that. One is our urban stormwater. That's about half the development load. And the other half is coming from our wastewater treatment plants. What's really monumental, though, is if you took this same chart and went back to 1985, instead of seeing 25% or a quarter of the load from wastewater, you would see it almost at 50%. What a monumental accomplishment. But that low-hanging fruit, we're using that up, so we need to find some other solutions. So where are we? Let's look back to 1985. These graphs represent the individual source sectors, but really starting on the left and moving all the way to the right, as Don pointed out earlier, tremendous progress. What's driving that progress? Well, wastewater, agriculture, and also work and investment in our Clean Air Act has been driving the progress. This is our nitrogen loads. You can see basically the blue driving down. Look at that blue box all the way back in 1985 for wastewater. Significant reductions. Also significant reductions for our agriculture. That puts us pretty close to the goal, but you see that steep curve beginning to level off. So we need to close that gap between 2009 and 2025. That's our important goal. That's where we have to go to get to 2025. Also, you know, that progress in the leadership in Maryland, a lot of the folks in the room that are working on this, I pointed out to Rich, green's my favorite color in this chart. Green is good. You know, we're doing well. We're moving forward on agriculture. Thank you. Urban stormwater, wastewater, all of these pieces, that's driving our progress. I appreciate the accountability because this chart comes out actually every year. Every 2 years, our milestones are evaluated. That's a really important point of this process. This isn't evaluated 10 years out. This is looking at each year and how do we move forward. If we take a closer look and look at 2009 to 2025, and we look at our projections, where we're going to be, the expectation is we'll probably get to 2017. We'll meet that goal of reducing 60%, a little bit more than half of what we need to reduce to get to 2025. But if you look at those 2 points, 2009 to 2017 and then 2017 onward, see how steep it is to 2017? We will have completed our 67 major wastewater treatment plant upgrades by 2017. Those are driving, that's a major part driving our reductions between now and 2017. Then it starts to level off. Population increase, wastewater treatment plant load increases. The key is, what are the solutions that are going to take us to 2025? And notice all the way on the end, there's a little gap. We're in a good place, but there's still a gap. How are we going to close that gap? When we look at phosphorus, what you'll see is information out there of, you know, we're making progress, but really our estimates today are probably optimistic. You'll see that we're well below, we're on our way to meeting our goals. But if we look back through just the last 5 years, the science community and the thinking has changed. All the phosphorus that was assumed to be bound up in the soils, once it becomes saturated, is actually leaking out. A lot of this is being taken into what Secretary Grumbel's talked about in the midpoint assessment. We need to think about this and put ourselves in a place that we can address this increased phosphorus, because we think this is probably a little bit more optimistic than what will likely be estimated in the next year or so. So let's take a look at our individual source sectors in Maryland. And when I say source sectors, wastewater, urban stormwater, septic systems, agriculture. Our modeling tools help us understand what's driving our implementation. And what's driving our implementation, knowing that, can help us optimize, can help us move this whole process in a positive direction. If we look at nitrogen and phosphorus, the one significant difference is different practices drive reductions in nitrogen versus phosphorus. For nitrogen, grass buffers, conservation tillage, forest buffers, again, buffers playing a significant part of it, also nutrient management. But when you move down to phosphorus, what you see is driving the reductions. Phytase, I think that started roughly 10 years ago, and we've been moving forward with that, reducing the nutrients actually in the manure, and then also our ag waste management system. So we need to think in terms of nutrients a little bit more specifically, which we have been, what's going to reduce nitrogen, what's going to reduce phosphorus. And again, significant progress within our agricultural sector, and take a look at those key drivers. Moving all the way down to precision conservation, using that technology that we were talking about earlier to better identify how to manage our fields. Putting us in a position to account for the changes that we expect to see in phosphorus is really another monumental effort, leadership in Maryland on implementing the phosphorus management tool. Tremendous amount of work, contentious issue, has been moved forward under the Hogan administration. And what this allows us to do is put us in a position to address those changes that we know are coming, using the science to inform our management. So right now we have on-farm soil samples. You'll probably see information up on MDA's website about that in terms of where we are. Roughly, I think, 20% of the fields right now do have higher levels of phosphorus in them. But also, and more importantly, what we're saying is here is that phosphorus restrictions occur on the highest fields. Full implementation prior to 2025, expect by 2022. And from an innovation perspective, we can think of one, either optimizing where the manure goes on the fields, higher saturated areas, manure would go to the lower phosphorus areas. Or some thinking for today, and also part of this agenda, is motivating new technologies. How do we deal with the waste? Where does it go? Are there opportunities, reuse opportunities, whether it's manure to energy? What may that be, and what options are going to be put on the table taking us to 2025? Wastewater treatment plants have really been a true success story. When you look at the 67 major wastewater treatment plants, they represent more than 90% of the nutrient load from wastewater. All 67 will be upgraded, we expect, by 2017, two of the largest, Patapsco and Back River, actually occurring within the next 2 years. It's a success story because it's had dedicated funding. I think roughly, $1.2 billion have gone into this, allowed upgrades to the highest level of technology, enhanced nutrient removal, builds capacity for population growth, and now we need to think about what's next, targeting some of those miners. One of the challenges that we face is we always have to look at this from an economic point of view. How do we best invest the money that we have to provide the greatest return for the environment? If we look at this, we can see on the right-hand side, this is cost per pound removed. So for how much money would it cost for me to remove 1 pound of nitrogen? Our major wastewater treatment plants have been highly cost-effective. Even the largest ones, it's an economy of scale. As we get to the smaller ones, it becomes more expensive. We lose that benefit of economy of scale. How do we address that? And that's one of the challenges we have moving forward. It gets back to Don's point of the low-hanging fruit. We've addressed that low-hanging fruit. Now, how do we better optimize this piece over here, or how do we look outside wastewater? Looking at wastewater from a different point of view are septic systems. You can look at septic systems. While it's only 6% of the load for nitrogen, the phosphorus is actually bound up in the soil. Our approach so far has been a cost-effective approach. Let's look at connections. How can we connect? Where can we connect our septic systems to wastewater facilities? It's a very cost-effective practice. Also, septic connections, septic upgrades. Those upgrades, and if you think about these three zones, think about this. Very close to tidal waters, all the way on the left-hand side. Those septic systems that are close to tidal waters are more cost-effective. They're discharging directly to the bay tidal waters. That's the area that we've been focusing on, and that's the continued thinking that we need, is how do we focus on those cost-effective solutions? How do we use our modeling information to help inform that and validate with our monitoring? The other area is, if you think about urban stormwater now representing about a quarter of our nutrient load in Maryland. It's a significant challenge. And I have here perhaps the most significant financing and also infrastructure challenge we have. I have three dates on here, and if you notice, the larger portion of this pie, almost 75%, shows that most of the impervious areas in Maryland were actually put in place prior to 1985. Well, what's that mean? It means that prior to 1985, there is minimal to no stormwater management requirements. So a lot of the impervious area, water's just running off, limited or no water quality treatment. And the challenge is, how do you address that? How do you improve that? How do you get more water in the ground? And how do you deal with that existing infrastructure? A challenge that we have both for local, protecting our streams, and also what it contributes down to our bay. Well, what are some of the solutions for that? The programmatic capacity that Rich talked about, ensuring that we have programmatic capacity. Through Department of the Environment, we have MPDS, basically federal permits that regulate, have regulatory requirements to address probably more than 80% of those nutrient loads. They're referred to MS4 permits, Municipal Separate Storm Sewer System permits. But it's not about just the permits, it's about the solutions to make the on-the-ground activities happen. We've heard that if you implement urban stormwater practices, it can take 1 year for design, 1 year for permit review, 1 year for construction. How do we make that more efficient? These are restoration practices. They're there to provide environmental and ecologic uplift. So can we increase the efficiency in the permit review process? Also, how do we work with local jurisdictions so we ensure that there's financial capacity within that local jurisdiction? Another requirement of the MS4 permits. Expand funding opportunities. The Bay Restoration Fund has revisions in it that allow stormwater funding in 2018, so after 2017. Also, the trust fund. Trading is another option, using market-based approaches to trade, maybe for the short time, while the restoration in the urban environments continue. Trading doesn't need to be a permanent trade, it can be a trade in time, and work towards your goals to continue and restore both the bay and local water quality. And build more partnerships. You'll hear about this later today from Prince George's County with a public-private partnership approach, how that can gain efficiencies and cost savings. So looking ahead, where do we need to be? We worked with the Environmental Finance Center, and I think you'll hear from Dan later today on some of this. Do we have the capacity, financial capacity for restoration? Few points here. Restoration is achievable. What does that mean and why is it achievable? Well, it's because we likely have the revenue through the BRF, through the trust fund, through our agricultural cost share to solve the problem. To do that, though, we need to make sure that we continue to focus and increase our focus on cost efficiency, cost effectiveness. We have a certain pot of money. How do we best spend that? And we must mitigate the impacts of pollution growth. If we're seeing pollution growth occur somewhere, how do we mitigate that? As was pointed out earlier, success doesn't end in 2025. We want to be under that cap, that nutrient and sediment cap, by 2025, but we need to continue to address the changes that we see and we know are occurring on our landscape. So we can't just say it all ends in 2025, it must continue. This is one view of maximizing our investment performance. All this is telling you is there's many different practices. Rich said there's more than 400. And this is the cost per pound. The red just means that urban practices are more expensive. Why is that? Because of the infrastructure challenges. It's an expensive practice to put in. Agricultural practices tend to be less cost effective. And the question is, why do these bars range so much? Well, the bars range so much because it depends on where you put your practice within your watershed. You can actually increase your cost effectiveness by having better targeting, identifying hotspots, identifying areas that will have more downstream or local environmental benefit. We can shrink those bars or use that range in the bars to better target our implementation. This blue bar right here, those are wastewater treatment plants. The range is so high because some are small plants, some are large plants. It depends on where they're located. So we can use this information to improve efficiency. And we also need to think broader. When we look at the cost of urban stormwater, think about the broader ecosystem value. Think about more markets, whether it's wetlands, whether it's stream restoration, whether it's carbon, that these practices can provide. And basically, greener practices result in broader value, not just nutrients, but the other impacts it has, whether it's public health, aesthetics, social value. These are all influence and are positive impacts to both the environment and the economy. So this needs to be factored into our thinking in terms of our restoration process. Implement a cross-sector trading program. You've heard the number, I'm sure, $14 billion for restoration. Well, how do we reduce that cost? Well, some sectors are moving a little faster than others. Some sectors are moving slower. How do you trade between the two to equalize that cost a little bit? Again, remembering that success doesn't end in 2025. So implementing some type of trading program to allow movement of loads among the sectors is incredibly important. Finally, it's verification. We need to ensure that the investments that we make in the environment, the practices that we put in the ground, are providing the environmental return that we said they would. We also need to make sure, it's like our home, taking care of our home and maintaining our home. We need to make sure that we continue to maintain it so it provides that return. Over the next 2 years, we're going to be ramping up what's called a verification process, ensuring that the practices that we report are in fact in the ground and they're working. This is part of an EPA requirement. It's not only Maryland doing this, all seven jurisdictions are working towards this. And I really like the work that's come together with the Chesapeake and Atlantic Coastal Bays Trust Fund. I pulled one of their reports in the cover page of the reports, managing the effectiveness of best management practices. As we put them in their ground, let's ensure that we're monitoring at least a portion of them. And let's coordinate our monitoring efforts so that we can understand, are these practices working better or worse than we originally thought. If they're working better, I'm going to go talk to Rich and I'm going to say, hey, you know, these are actually working better. If they're working worse, we're going to have the same conversation. But we need to know what's actually working and what's not. Finally, it's about accounting for changes on the landscape. Basically, what I have here is the view of the landscape. We have animal populations and also people increasing. I think a million more people expected between 2010 and 2025 in Maryland. Animal populations changing. Well, what does that mean? Well, it means that we need to improve and build upon, innovate, have more manure treatment technologies. The other challenges that we face is by 2025, or in 10 years, we expect to lose roughly 300,000 acres of land to development. This is working with our Department of Planning folks. About half of that will probably be from cropland. About half of that will probably be from forest land. Fortunately, as we move to development, we have several practices. And this is what we want to show for Maryland, the example of what is working and how do we deal with this. Well, let's build upon and ensure that what we have in place is actually working. Whether it's as we have new CAFOs, we have CAFO permits, implementing the phosphorus management tool. We have nutrient management requirements under law, ensuring those are working. We have record cover crops, more than 400,000 last year, and I hear more than 500,000 this year. Forest buffers, as I've talked about. We probably have some of the most progressive stormwater management practices in the nation. I won't say environmental site design, even though I did. I look at it as greener practices and trying to get more water in the ground. So let's make sure that, you know, we're counting this, we know, and we can document what's happening. Also now, with new development, we have probably a quarter going to septic systems and most of that going to wastewater treatment plants. Again, more effective. That's how we think about what's happening in the future, and this is what we need to document and show and adjust if necessary. I did skip one, which is the Forest Conservation Act, preserving certain forest lands. So let's take a look at this as we account for our growth and our landscape changes over the in the future. And let's optimize and adjust as needed. Might not be perfect, but it's an approach that we are looking at the system as a whole. And honestly, we have been for some time. Finally, you've heard from several presenters, the Conowingo. Absolutely. Is it a top priority? Yes, we need to make sure we're addressing changes. It's not only about changes that are happening on the landscape. It's changes that we're seeing, those trends that we are seeing throughout the watershed as a whole. Given just the size of the Susquehanna watershed and its influence, we absolutely need to make sure that we address this. As water flows across the dam, what we've seen for some time, going back to 1929 and moving all the way up to, I think, about 2012, it's been filling with sediment and nutrients from upstream. As it's been filling, what you're seeing here is, for a while, phosphorus loads were continuing to go down, just like sediment loads. And then there came a point they're starting to go back up. It's just using the science and accounting for changes, and then using this information to drive solutions, whether the solutions are upstream, downstream, or within the pond itself. Finally, for the summary, where we are now, it's great. We have a long history of progress in Maryland. Excellent leadership, and the leadership that we put forward, from what I see, translates to other states. They look at where Maryland is, they look at the solutions Maryland's providing, and it pushes them and encourages them to implement those solutions. The other point is restoration success is achievable. We have funding in place, we have programmatic capacity in place, we have a lot of pieces in place that we continue to need to push forward and put resources towards to make sure they get us to our 2025 goals and beyond. So I underlined a few key words that I thought were important to me. Optimize comes to mind. Optimize our implementation so that we are spending the dollars in the most cost-effective manner. Partnerships. We can't do any of this without our partnerships. And partnerships can be as broad as, or as I guess narrow as public-private partnerships within smaller communities, but broader partnerships when we think about market-based approaches, thinking about air, carbon credits, wetlands, stream restoration, bringing all that together in a much broader partnership, thinking about one water, one environment. And that gets to expanding our market opportunities. develop and incorporate new technologies. The slope of implementation was pretty steep, and then it leveled off. What are those new technologies that are going to actually get us across that 2025 finish line? Finally, account for changes. We need to look at the past, what's on the ground, and put restoration and implementation in place. But also, what do we expect to see changing in the future? And if we know what's going to change, how do we take that opportunity and use that opportunity to put cost-effective practices in place and programs in place to address that? So with that, I really hope you enjoyed the trip from the watershed scale with Rich down to the finer scale with Maryland. Did I miss my time limit?
You're doing great.
All right. I was just... Oh. Thank you.
Yeah, the question was, do we have the tools in place at the right scale?
So I look at tools as one being, what are the implementation tools? I think we can improve upon the implementation tools by using higher level, like the information that Ben talked about, better targeting approaches at a finer scale. I think there's opportunities to develop those. We have a lot of tools in place. Yes, I think we have the programmatic capacity to take us to 2017. I think we need to be more innovative and put some more solutions on the table as we go from 2017 to 2025. So we need to think about that. We're also not thinking, we're thinking a lot in the watershed, and we're not thinking about implementation that can occur actually in the tidal waters. So you'll see a presentation later today about aquaculture. You know, what can actually happen in the tidal waters that can improve our water quality? So it's a combination of looking at both upstream and expanding our thinking in the tidal waters to include other opportunities. Okay.
Here, I've got a... Errol, wait a minute.
Legacy phosphorus. There's researcher at UD suggesting, maybe, we don't know, that the phosphorus we see moving is the legacy phosphorus. What's your plan B if that's true?
There's two approaches, or two ways to think about phosphorus. One is legacy phosphorus. How do you treat what's already there? And I think that's what you're saying. So what are those implementation practices, whether it's ditches or this... or those wood chips they put in, basically, those new ideas to begin to trap and pull that phosphorus out before it gets to the stream. So I think those are some of the solutions that need to be on the table, and to an extent, they are already on the table. And the second way of thinking is, don't let the fields get saturated again.
One of the things that some of you all were at last year, we had a symposium on just focus on phosphorus, brought in national experts, international experts. It was amazing. The level of science and level of holes in our science on phosphorus compared to nitrogen. You know, for a while there, we didn't know phosphorus, we didn't know nitrogen, we got introduced to nitrogen, understood it. So it's not only those pieces. I think the science is still, we've got to drive that. And some cases, our policy got a little ahead of the science came in there. So it's not only the tools, we need to understand that system better. We've got some trends that we're seeing in the monitoring data that just gets us to scratch our heads. And the question is it legacy? Is there something else in there? What are we missing on that phosphorus side? So continue what we've got out there, but really push on that science and that interpretation, that monitoring record that we've got.
Just to add on that, from a science point of view, the information that's coming in right now of soil samples on all those fields, I think that plays a really critical role, because it begins to kind of narrow the acres down to, okay, here's a smaller set of acres that we know we're seeing very high levels are saturated. So the question becomes, okay, now we've narrowed it down, what are the solutions to begin to address those saturated fields and the legacy phosphorus? I don't have all the answers for you, but I think it's an opportunity that we have moving forward to address that.
Thank you. I have some real concern about this 2017 model, and I don't know whether they're going to address it further here on down, but Maryland has, and I'm with agriculture, so I'm concerned about that in particular, but we have some figures with the Department of Agriculture that shows exactly how much fertilizer we're putting down. I know with the model it shows a great deal more, or so it was explained early on. So where are we on this improvements to the model, And how close do those numbers now agree compared to what you're looking at it redoing the model?
You know, he's handing it to me, but he actually chairs the partnership's group of scientists and managers that are overseeing it. Now you know when your friends are there. You know, you've got it. You've got an excellent point. I'm going to move away from you, Lee. So it's not just one model, folks. It's actually a suite of models that actually looks at what Ben mentioned, air sheds. So in other words, we're looking at nitrogen oxides that are coming out of China and across globally and across the United States to look at air sheds. One of our key models is a model of the entire Chesapeake Bay watershed, sort of a huge accountability system. We also got a model looking at land use changes in the past history, as well as forward from our USGS colleagues. Those tools all contribute to a model of the Chesapeake Bay waters. So in other words, you got to capture those tides, you got to capture salt. And in there, we are looking at the critters. We've got models that look at underwater grasses and algae and zooplankton and Don's benthic critter friends that he's going to join someday out there as well. So, sir, your point's a good one, and that is it starts and stops with what's being applied to the land, either by farmers or our urban farmers, what they're putting on their backyards out there. So past record, you're right. We did not do a good job of capturing the fertilizer. I would have thought fertilizer sales would have been a smart thing to do. They're not a good source of data. So we've been working more directly with Maryland Department of Ag and others to get the best measurements of what's happening there. So this round, are we going to be perfect? Perfect? No. It's only as good as the data sets that are out there, but we've got a lot more fertilizer sales and application information and better sense, as Ben mentioned, knowing what lands are in production out there. But what's going to be make us all honest is that 30, 40-year record of monitoring data out there. So we're going to put the information in there. We're going to calibrate it. We're going to look in the Chickawacomico. We're going to look in the Nanticoke. We're going to look in the Tuckahoe and see, are those monitoring data showing what we're seeing up in there? And if there's a disconnect, we're going to go back to our information to be sure it's there as well. And we're going to provide opportunities for you all as well, not to trust Lee and I, but to look for yourselves. It may, you know, if you have insomnia, we are going to welcome you guys in the coming months to look at model output, look at sales data, look at your land use, land cover and stuff, because we want your fingerprints on it. 2017 is too important for you all not to understand what's going on out there. What this model is controlling you? Absolutely not. It's a way to synthesize millions of data points. I'm going to say put Bill Dennison's brain on steroids and capture it in there. It wouldn't capture it. But we want to be sure you guys have got the comfort level because of what the challenges we have up in front of us. So an excellent question, and I look forward to you and I looking over each other's shoulders and seeing, is that fertilizer data in there, and is the Tuckahoe coming back? Because those yellows are spawning up there, and I need to get out fishing.
And I'll just add a short comment to that. So after we finished, or after the first model was completed, we had a chance to use it, exercise it, understand what was happening. And one thing we said is we don't agree with all of it, part of it, I'm going to say all of it. We don't agree with some of the items in there. But this is the best we have for now. This is the best information. And immediately we started working on what are the refinements that we want to make. So when you hear about, okay, there's refinements in 2017, many of those began in 2012. We've been working on that closely. Our Department of Agriculture has been very invested, spent a significant amount of time to make this version better than it was before, both with respect to manure, fertilizer, phosphorus, whatever it may be.
Last question.
I'm with Talbot County Government, and one critical issue that's right in front of us right now is Conowingo. And we had a recent bad history of pushback from efforts on part of Tioga County, particularly on the Eastern Shore with the Conowingo issue. In order for us to sustain the support and commitment of the decision makers, we have to have a clear, understandable game plan for addressing the Conowingo. Otherwise, we're going to lose a lot of energy and commitment.
Sure. I hope, and I guess we haven't done. Yeah, I'm going to let you let Bennett address that one. Well, that's good.
You guys notice a trend here, model? Yeah. Goes to me, you kind of go to Ben, and you're stepping out there. We have to sing a song about kind of Wingo. Oh no.
No, I all I wanted to do was to say that Governor Hogan asked the very same question and made the same comment in briefings with secretaries yesterday. He's really enthused about collaborating with EPA and the other states and with the scientific community to develop a meaningful action plan on Conowingo. And so we're looking specifically at, over the next several months, the outreach with our federal partners, the leadership, and including USDA and including the Army Corps of Engineers, but really developing a forum for discussing how best to prepare ourselves for the midpoint assessment, and also for the Clean Water Act 401 water quality certification process that we've got in the context of the dams relicensing with FERC. We, like I said, governor holds a powerful veto over the relicensing of the dam, and we know that through collaboration and through science-driven policymaking, 2017 is going to be a very busy, very important year to make the most of it, and that means working with everybody, including our partners in Pennsylvania. We're very encouraged by the governor of Pennsylvania's efforts, the Secretary of Environment's efforts to reboot, to do more. You know, that'll help as well. But thank you for asking the question, Talbot County, about Conowingo. It's going to define for us a lot of planning for the rest of this year and have a very active 2017. You want to have anything?
Well, thanks. Let's get a hand on the speakers. Thanks, Rich.